You're listening to a Frequency Podcast Network production.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
This is the Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Welcome to Tuesday. I'm Dalby. This is the Brock and Dalby Podcast. A look back at the best of the stuff that happened today, which unfortunately only involved me. My good friend Brock is out sick, could be gone for a few days, but the show does carry on, and that includes the podcast as well. So to make sure that you're getting your dose of the man, we are going to have some best of clips, some throwback stuff, some bad memories, as we like to call them, going back into the archives of the show. Plus, today, got to chat about how AI convinced people to go to the province of Saskatchewan to look for purple apples. Let's do that right now.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Having lived in Saskatchewan for a number of years, I like to keep up on what's going on out there with the news. I've still got a lot of friends and co-workers and things back out there, so I'm always seeing different stories and things on Facebook, and it's been really cool to see that there's been a bit of a tourism boom in Saskatchewan. People have been coming from different parts of North America, very curious to get to Saskatchewan to see the purple apple starting to grow out on the trees. 'Tis the season where purple apples are growing in Saskatchewan. Now, if you're listening to that and you go, the hell is he talking about purple apples? You're smarter than a lot of people, because the tourism thing was very true. People are traveling to Saskatchewan to see the purple apples. But the purple apples was an AI photograph that went viral, got thousands and thousands and thousands of views in a Facebook group down in California, or was based around people who lived in California. And when pressed on, hey, is this AI? They said, no, it's actually purple apples that are grown in very small parts in Saskatchewan. And people were like, oh my God, that's so cool. If you want to see the pictures, text Apple to 762-555. I'll send you the story from CTV. It's a very convincing photo. It's a bushel of apples. They look almost plum-esque, grape-like in their coloring. But the whole thing is AI-generated, and it really does open the discussion that, once again, seeing is believing is not a sentence that we can actually follow anymore. That is no longer the case, because I see this picture with my own eyes and I go, wow, those are very realistic looking purple apples. But I also have a brain, and I feel like at some point in my almost 41 years of existence, I would have learned that there are purple apples that grow only in one province in this country and nowhere else on earth. We need to start doing better at being skeptical of things. And that's a bummer, because you want to have an open mind. You want to be open to the wonders of the world. Sometimes this planet of ours still does things that surprise us. But if you pack up the car and you pack up the kids and you drive to Saskatchewan because you saw a picture on the internet that told you that purple apples grow there, then maybe you need to open your eyes or go back to grade school for a little bit. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just saying, how did anybody fall for this? They're purple apples.
Going back in the archives, this is a bad memory from the Brock and Dalby Show.
762-555, we're talking about celebrities that you should not mess with, because if you didn't know, Tom Hardy is a Brazilian jiu-jitsu master. He's been entering competitions in the UK and absolutely just whooping ass. He slipped into one last week. No one even knew it was actually him, and he ended up getting first place.
No one knew he was there until he was holding a gold medal.
Imagine, like, you're like, whoa, who am I fighting? They're like, Tom Hardy. You're like, oh, that's funny.
I wonder if he gets the joke a lot about having the same name as that actor.
And then you get in there and you're fighting Bane? Oh, God. 762-555, we were asking you celebrities that you should not mess with. Of course, we've got Chuck Norris, Steven Seagal, Jean-Claude Van Damme are some standard ones. We were saying Jason Statham as well. Someone was saying Vince Vaughn is actually a blue belt.
Really?
Which, he's a big dude. He's got to be like 6'4", 6'5".
I was going to say, he's super tall.
I could see him packing like a mean punch or something, dude.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, that would be, he would be very difficult. He'd be very rangy. You know what else we saw in the text line that shocked me?
Yeah.
Ed O'Neill, better known as Al Bundy.
Yeah.
Is a BJJ black belt.
Interesting. He's a big dude too.
He is a kind of a bigger fella, but he could roll you before you even knew what was going on.
Steve texted in at 762-555. He said, guys, you got to think about Keanu Reeves. Think about all the training he's done for the John Wick movies.
True.
Yeah.
Plus, it's always the quiet ones.
You're
and
right?
He's like the definition. He's totally. Not in the movies.
He's one of the only celebrities that takes the transit in New York City.
Right.
That dude is ready.
Like, he's not scared of anything.
Danny Trejo.
Oh, that's a great text. That actually came in from a few different people. Danny Trejo has made literally a career on being one of the most terrifying people
in the
world.
He's done some time, too. He was in, like, San Quentin or something at one point.
I believe so. He has a Nickelback song.
He's legit, dude. He's a Gerard Butler from 300.
When he's shredded, he's pretty nuts.
He does have those angry eyes.
That's true.
And if he can kick like he did in 300, wouldn't want to mess with
him. The big push kick?
Yeah.
Yeah, just don't stand next to any open pits. You'll be fine.
Here's a question for you. If in your weight class,
okay,
what celebrity do you think you could actually fight?
Oh,
in your weight class, or like relatively close,
right? So, like, I'm down to 300, so it'd be somewhere in that.
I'll say anywhere from like 200 to 300, something like that.
Oh, you know who weighs about what I do that I could absolutely crush? Kim Jong Un. I was looking at this the other day.
Whoa!
He's lost about the same amount of weight as me.
Shots fired.
We were both at around 350. Now we're both down at around 300.
You realize you just put our radio show on a list by saying that?
It's North Korea. I'm not worried about it. I'm saying in a scenario, say like a boxing, like a charity boxing or something. If I got my hands on Kim Jong-un, I feel like I come out the victor.
That is the boldest thing I've ever heard anyone say before.
You don't think you could beat Kim Jong-un in a fight?
I don't even want to declare such a statement.
I also have to be choosy with who I say. I weigh 300 pounds.
Sure, yeah.
Most people in my weight class are like bodybuilders.
I'm just worried that we're not going to survive the weekend after that statement.
Listen, they've been testing missiles for years. None of them are making it this far.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Almost had no show today. I, like a responsible adult, forgot to plug my phone in. My phone, of course, is my alarm, as with most people in 2024. So my phone died somewhere in the middle of the night. Luckily, I woke up naturally about half an hour after when I should normally wake up, which is still within the range of being reasonable to get into work in the morning. But I did have that moment. You know when you're laying in bed and you wake up and you know your alarm is not going off. So now you are in this no man's land of like, it's either too early or something's gone wrong and I've slept through my alarm. This is either, it's bad in either direction. Either you've woken up way too early or you're absolutely way too late. One of the worst feelings in the world, because now you have to argue with yourself. If I've woken up too early, I don't want to open my eyes. I don't want to wake up to check the time because then I might not get back to sleep. Whereas if I just lay here and keep my eyes closed and I keep focused, I might be able to fall back asleep until my alarm goes off. But if I have slept through or my alarm has been disabled somehow, I need to wake up now or else I will be late for whatever it is that I'm supposed to be doing currently. So today I decided, I was like, something doesn't feel right. Open my eyes, tap my phone, nothing. Hit the button on my phone, nothing. Realize, it's stone cold dead. And then you have that gut feeling, that sinking to the stomach feeling of like, oh no, how late am I? But of course, I don't have a clock in my room. My partner doesn't have anything, so I have to plug in my phone and I have to wait for it to get to 1% on the battery so I can turn it back on again. Luckily, it was the weirdest feeling. It was the first time I've ever realized I was late, but been relieved because it could have been worse. I could have been so much more late.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
What is the worst feeling that someone can wake up to? Ashley hit it on the head with something that many, many people have experienced. Pet owners, when you have to clean up pet puke before you even get to that first coffee of the day, whether it is cat or dog. I find probably more often cat than dog, especially when you wake up and you hear that from down the hall and you're like, it's already too late. Even if I was to fly in from under these covers and break the sound barrier down the hall to try and get the cat somewhere where this puke will not be as devastating, there is no way. Once the motion is started, it cannot be stopped. Of course, the only worst thing than waking up to hearing it happen is not hearing it happen and then stepping in it as you're walking to go get said first cup of coffee. Speaking of coffee, Tammy said, realizing that I forgot to pick up cream for my coffee. If you are a coffee drinker, and I can't fully relate because I've never drank coffee in my life, but for people who drink coffee every day, it's not only a habit, it becomes part of like almost a ritual, right? That's why people say they need their coffee in the morning, is because we're creatures of habit, creatures of ritual. You wake up, you go pee, you go to make your coffee. Maybe while that's brewing, you do something else, you feed the dog or whatever it is. And then you have that first cup of coffee and now you're ready to start the day. And to wake up only to realize that you don't have cream, you don't have sugar, you don't have milk, you don't have coffee. I've seen people freak out for that before. It completely throws off your entire day. Now, for some people, the text line 762-555, the worst feeling in the world, we got this from a few people, is just remembering that you do, in fact, have a job that you have to go to, that it is a weekday, a work day, and you have to get up because you have bills to pay because somebody in the history of humanity decided that life should be expensive, and you have to go and work for that money. Also a terrible feeling, although it is worse, as Renee said, to wake up on a Saturday or a Sunday thinking that you have to go to work. Getting dressed in a panic because you're like, oh my God, I didn't even set an alarm. I'm so dumb. And then remembering it is, in fact, a Saturday. That is a feeling that'll make you just crawl back into bed and go, you know what? Not today. We're just not doing today.
This is the Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Over in Kelowna, British Columbia, a pair of pigs have been out and about in the town. They got loose. They have been wreaking havoc on people's rose bushes and causing a bit of a scene, running around on the roads. Well, last week, finally, police cornered the two pig fugitives on the playground of a local elementary school and then spent the better part of an hour chasing them down. Up to five uniformed officers, as well as close to a dozen other adults, presumably faculty from the elementary school and local passerbys, spent nearly an hour corralling the two pigs. The whole time, school-age elementary school children were standing on the sidelines cheering for the pigs to evade capture by the adults. Just when you thought you were having a tough day at your job, it has to be utterly devastating to be a police officer chasing down barnyard animals, hearing school children go, "Go, pigs, go!"
Going back in the archives, this is a bad memory from the Brock and Dalby Show.
What's the most ridiculous way you've seen someone spell a basic name? 762-555. We're talking about this because we were talking about the spelling of the name Connor. And how for some reason there's so many different variations. And yes, we have Googled it. The correct way to spell Connor, the Irish traditional way, is C-O-N-N-O-R.
Mm-hmm.
And then C-O-N-N-E-R is the North American take on the name. And then all the in-betweens is just parents trying to be unique with their kids is what we're figuring out.
It's just everybody trying to have a little fun, you know?
Yeah, I feel like that's exactly what it is. It's like some parents just tried to make their kids way too unique. You see it with the Brendan. Like, it's either the A-N, the O-N, the I-N, Y-N.
I have a friend named Brendan. And, like, I was asking, we were commiserating because you know what people do to my name.
Mm.
We were commiserating, and he was telling me all the different ways that people mangle his name. Even if you're a Brendan, they'll think you're a Brandon.
Yeah.
They'll think you're... Oh, it's just awful.
I just feel like we need to have, like, a Hunger Games-type style battle. And maybe...
For naming?
Yeah, maybe we can have, like, a voting system. And if you're like, one of the Brendans or a Jordan or maybe even a Sarah, you know what I mean? And you've got all these different variations of how your name's spelled, we can have a voting system and you can pick one person for each spelling of the name.
Sure.
To come out and Royal Rumble, like, battle it all out or something, you know?
Who's your champion for Sean? because I know that name drives you crazy.
So you've got the S-E-A-Ns, you've got the S-H-A-W-Ns, you've got the S-H-A-U-N. Like, that would honestly be an all-out brawl out,
absolutely.
Dude. The Sean's in the Haley's, actually.
Oh, dude, Haley's a mess.
I have seen people spell Haley in the most catastrophic ways possible.
I mean, right off the start, first three letters, you've got H-A-Y's, you've got H-A-I's, some just H-A's, which I feel like that's lazy.
Yeah.
Then you get the L, that's pretty standard. What comes after the L feels like a game of Boggle. Like, it's just a dice roll,
man. It's like people were trying to see how many letters they could slip in there. You know?
The E-I-G-H is unconscionable.
Either we have them fight it out, or it's mandatory that when you're filing your kid's name, if it gets a red underline from spell check, you can't use that name, all right?
I love the idea of having a uniform list of spellings, and then instead of having the parents write the name down, they just say it.
Yeah.
They just say, my child's name will be Sean.
Mm.
And the nurse says, oh, okay, and goes to the database. Oh, the official spelling, S-H-A-W-N. Done. On the birth certificate.
And if you refuse that, then your kid is never allowed to get mad when someone calls them the wrong name.
That's the sacrifice.
Right?
That's the sacrifice.
Them's the rules.
You have to pay a deposit to give your child a weird name.
It's either that or Hunger Games. All right? Which one do you like better?
The Brock and Dalby.
Brock and Dalby
Podcast.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
A lady by the name of Shirley Curry, who is better known in most circles on the internet as the Skyrim Grandma. She rose to fame online doing videos of herself playing the video game Skyrim, Elder Scrolls, and now at the age of 88 years old, with 1.3 million subscribers watching her gaming videos and streams on YouTube, she has decided that she is retiring from making gaming videos, but is very clear that she will still be playing games just for her own purposes, her own entertainment, and not for the entertainment of the said 1.3 million subscribers, saying, I was supposed to be doing it for fun, and it isn't fun anymore. And I get that. I think we've all been there where maybe you're doing something as a hobby, and then maybe you're really good at it. It takes off. People get interested in it. Maybe you do crafting, that sort of thing. And all of a sudden, you're doing it for other people. You're doing it for reasons not why you started it. And things can become less fun when you go about doing it that way. But mostly what I took away from this was, man, I hope when I'm 88 years old, I'm still playing video games. I have already taken some flack. Here I am. I'll be 41 next week. And I take flack every now and again for two things. One, watching professional wrestling as an adult. And two, playing video games. Aren't you too old for that? That's for kids. Those are things kids do. Yeah, but you know what? Once a week when I watch Monday Night Raw, or a few times a week when I sit down and get on my Xbox, I get to feel like a kid again. I don't have to worry about paying the mortgage. I don't have to worry about making supper. I don't have to worry about any of the responsibilities that come with being an adult for this short amount of time where I'm doing the thing that people sort of frown upon when you grow up. You're not supposed to play video games anymore. Well, I hope when I'm 88 years old that we're Xbox 47 or whatever it might be, the way that these things are going, I hope I've got one. I hope it's hooked up to the TV. I hope I'm playing some sort of Halo game or some other nonsense that people have created. Maybe virtual reality will be a thing by then, and I won't even have to get up out my walker or wheelchair, and I can just play the video games without ever having to leave the comfort of my own home. I would love that.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Got a number of people that said, I hope when I'm in my 80s, I'm still going to concerts. And honestly, I will say, when you go to a concert, especially some of the, like, the heavier concerts, and you kind of fight your way up to the front or whatever, or you get towards the pit, and you see somebody who's in their later years, let's just put it. They got the gray hair. They're, you know, maybe leaning on a rail or two, but also they're looking at the pit like, I could still get in there. I could still throw the elbows if I needed to. That makes me happy. Like, I see that and I'm like, hell yes, that's amazing. I want to be that person when I get there in 20, 30 years. That's what I'm hoping for. Also saw this one from Tim. Says hunting, fishing, definitely still no reason to not be doing those. If anything, by the time you get to 88, like Skyrim Grandma, if you've been hunting and fishing your whole life, you know all the good spots, you know all the good baits. You become the person that people are going to for the hunting and fishing advice. You become like the guru of the forest, which is a pretty cool thing to have. Also saw a few texts that say that I hope that I'm never too old to play golf. I agree wholeheartedly. The good news is that my skill level in golf cannot decline. I am already bad at it, so as I get older, I will only have more of an excuse to be terrible at it. But I would love to be in my mid to late 80s, out on the cart, roaming the course, duffing around. I think that would be a fantastic way to spend some of my later years. Dan just says, I hope I can still find companionship. He didn't quite phrase it that way, but you know what? At 88, I hope we all find that, Dano.
This is the Brock and Dalby Podcast.
People are very excited because if you are the type to text like an Egyptian and speak mostly in pictures instead of actually writing out words, there are new emojis coming out to the phone. Apparently, they do a thing every year where people can vote. I've never actually seen the voting, but people can vote on which emojis that have been created will actually be sent out and put onto iPhones, Androids, all of those things. And the top vote getter this year was a face with bags under its eyes, the exhausted emoji. Coming to phones soon, which I do think is kind of funny because you would use like someone's like, hey, how you doing? And you would just send back this grumpy looking, bags under the eyes, exhausted looking face. And it would just say to me, if someone texted me the exhausted face, I was like, oh, well, you still had enough energy to send the text. Like you must be doing at least okay. It just feels like people like to use the emojis a little bit too much. Maybe this is the sign that I'm getting a little bit old. Because I cannot get into the emojis. I'm okay with, like, reacting. You know, you can react to someone's text. You can put a little heart on it or maybe a smiley face or a laugh. I'm okay there, but I kind of draw the line. Other than sending, like, a heart emoji to my girlfriend, beyond that, I'm just like, just write the words. We have such a complex, rich language. It takes literally no time. You don't even have to spell the words right anymore. Your phone will fix it for you. Why do we need an emoji of a beat? Because that's another one that apparently did very good in the voting this year, is being sent out to phones in the next month or so. A beat, there's a fingerprint emoji, there's a tree with no leaves on it, a shovel, a harp, and then some sort of purple goo splatter. And I can only imagine that that can only be sent with the worst of intentions. Under what circumstances would you ever text somebody a purple goo emoji and it be a good thing? Even the, because I know where your thoughts went, because it's where my thoughts went. First, I was like, oh, maybe people will use it when they're trying to set the tone, set the mood, an amorous kind of text message, or perhaps in the aftermath of telling your friends about what happened. But why is it purple? No one's having a good time in that situation. This is the emoji you send when you just got swabbed at the doctor and it didn't go well.
Going back in the archives, this is a bad memory from the Brock and Dalby Show.
So we have been censoring out a lot of words lately in songs. We have done love. We have done rock.
Yeah.
And what was the last one we did?
Heart.
We did heart
as well. Yeah.
And it makes a big difference when you censor these things out in songs. It can really make a love song sound a lot different for most of them.
It really just takes the song's meaning,
mm-hmm.
and it allows your imagination to create a new story.
I got a message from, who was it? It was Chris on Instagram, and he said, I think you should try and censor out cry or crying in songs. I think it could be interesting. And I'm not going to lie, this one was difficult.
Yeah.
This one was really difficult, but I've got some picks, and I think they kind of work. I mean, you could do it with this classic Journey song. It kind of works.
Yeah.
It kind of works.
It really hits.
Of course, you've got Aerosmith. It could work for this, too. A little bit of a stretch, but it's still, like, you know.
Yeah, no, it gives, there's an implication there.
I don't know if it makes as much sense. We'll listen again. But not even just in rock and roll. In country music, you know, if we step outside of our genre for a second.
There's a lot of crying in country.
Keith Urban. To hell with my pride, let it fall like rain. I apologize that I'm making you listen to this, by the way. Tonight I wanna
I mean, a lot of guys feel the same way.
You know? And then even if you get more into some country music, I think everyone can enjoy some Johnny Cash, it works really well.
The midnight train is whining low.
Wait for it.
I'm so lonesome, could
We've all been there, Johnny.
And are you familiar with Leslie Gore at all?
Leslie Gore. The name doesn't ring a bell.
You'll recognize it.
No. No. Come on. Leslie. Oh. That's inappropriate.
It really makes the song sound a lot different, doesn't it?
Sounds like a hell of a party, though.
And I'll wrap up with this one here. I almost forgot just before we came on air, and I was like, oh, yeah, Prince.
I never want to hear that sound. I never want to hear that sound in my entire life.
I want to apologize for ruining Prince for everyone this morning.
For more Brock and Dalby, tune in weekday mornings 5:30 to 9.
The Brock and Dalby podcast is brought to you by BadShop.ca, the Brock and Dalby merch store, with all proceeds going to the Canadian Cancer Society.